So I am sorry that I am moving you to English. You know, I will say the following about the Arab Peace Initiative. First of all, thank you very much for the invitation and for this gathering this evening. And I will say the following, starting to speak about the Arab Peace Initiative. Since I have the privilege of speaking Arabic, therefore I can read the website of the Arab League in Arabic, which I did. I want to tell you some of the unknown informations about the Arab Peace Initiative among the Israelis. There are some informations that you don't know, and this is not, of course, your problem. I think the Arab League also should have a website in Hebrew, which they don't have. If they want to talk about the Arab Peace Initiative, they should have what they have in Arabic, they should have it in Hebrew. But till then, till they will have it in Hebrew, I will tell you about some informations that you don't know about, that you do not read before, because they put it only in Arabic, and unfortunately. One of the things that I want to mention, that when the Arab Peace Initiative was released in 2002, it was not only the Arab Peace Initiative one-page document. There was, with the Arab Peace Initiative, that was one-page document, there was another document which is not less important than the Arab Peace Initiative, released in the same, you know, in the same summit of 2002. That second document is the communique, the resolution that was released from that summit in 2002. The communique is not, the communique or the resolution is not less important than the Arab Peace Initiative, because the communique said the following. First, the resolution or the communique said that the Arab Peace Initiative is not an alternative to the bilateral negotiations. Therefore, which means that the Arab Peace Initiative is not a take it or leave it plan. It is just an Arab offer to Israel, and this offer is not an alternative to the bilateral negotiations. They said clearly in the statement, in this resolution or communique, that bilateral negotiations will be the way ahead. The sides, the Palestinians, should have their bilateral negotiations with Israel, the same Syrians, the same the Lebanese. Therefore, there was a focus on the bilateral negotiations in order to make a breakthrough in peace between Arabs and Israel. Therefore, it's not only the Arab Peace Initiative full stop, it is Arab Peace Initiative plus the bilateral negotiations that will be the path or the tool or the channel that will lead to the two states, to the agreements between the Arabs and the Israelis. This is one. Second resolution, or second decision at that resolution, is the composition of the Arab Peace Initiative follow-up committee. The composition of the Arab Peace Initiative follow-up committee. That committee, it was decided that this committee will be composed of 12 countries chaired by Qatar. And this committee was asked to contact all the international community countries about the Arab Peace Initiative, Ever since, 2002, till today, the Arab Peace Initiative follow-up committee meet at least 5 to 6 times a year, to discuss ideas to promote the Arab Peace Initiative. And ever since, this committee of 12 countries were able to convince the United States of America to include the Arab Peace Initiative in the roadmap of 2003. They were able to convince the UN Security Council to include the Arab Peace Initiative in the resolutions of the UN Security Council 1850 of the year 2008. And 1860 of the year 2009. These are UN Security Council resolutions. Look at them. You'll find the Arab Peace Initiative included. they were also able to convince the quartet to include the Arab Peace Initiative in their resolution of 23rd of September 2010, which calls this resolution of the quartet calls for holding an international conference for peace in the Middle East based on the Arab Peace Initiative. So this is the achievements. Besides these achievements, they were able to bring the Arab Peace Initiative to the table of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, previously the Organization of Islamic Countries. And actually they did that in the meeting of the Organization of Islamic Countries in Tehran in 2003. At that conference of the Organization of the Islamic Countries held in Tehran in 2003, all the Islamic countries said yes to the Arab Peace Initiative except Iran, where the conference was held. So you have 56 Islamic countries who said, Islamic and Arab countries, who said to the Arab Peace Initiative. With all of that done, we can see that the Arab Peace Initiative became not only initiative of the Arab countries, but it is also an initiative of the Organization of the Islamic Countries and also an initiative that is included in the UN Security Council resolutions. Therefore, it is not anymore an Arab peace initiative. It is an international initiative. It became an international initiative included in UN Security Council resolutions. And with that said, you can see now that the promise of normalization with Israel is not only promise of 22 Arab countries, it is a promise of 56 Arab and Islamic countries. In case that Israel will have peace with the Arabs, 56 Arab and Islamic countries will normalize relations with Israel. This is the significance of what's said. The third resolution on that communique of 2002 is asking Egypt and Jordan, being the two countries who have relations with Israel, to communicate the Arab Peace Initiative with Israel. So this was the first decision, that asking Egypt and Jordan to communicate it with Israel, which Egypt and Jordan kept doing, communicating it with Israel since 2002. I will mention just an example in the Israeli previous Knesset, not this one, the previous one, received all the members of that Knesset, the 120, received a letter one by one from King Abdullah of Jordan about the Arab Peace Initiative, the text of it, and clarifications about it. So if nobody of those Knesset members can say we don't know about it, they receive it by hand from King Abdullah of Jordan with a letter clarifying what does it mean. And Jordan and Egypt kept talking about it to the Israeli, to the Israeli politicians all the way ahead since 2002 till today. So these are this is the communique that was made in 2002, which led the Arab Peace Initiative to become a peace initiative that is included in the Organization of Islamic Countries resolutions and also in the UN Security Council resolutions. Therefore, I will move from that to some. So this is about the significance of the Arab Peace Initiative. Secondly, you know, this was my first point, talking about it is the Arab Peace Initiative's significance. Its significance that it is an Arab Islamic international plan. This is its significance. The second point, that it is the only plan left for peace. Oslo process already reached its final destination, yeah, with all the love of my colleague Ron Pundak. It doesn't help getting the two people to an agreement. And the roadmap, you know what happened to the roadmap. Do anybody talk about it today? If we have a plan in order to move ahead in peace between the Arabs and between the Palestinians and the Israelis, it is now the Arab Peace Initiative. This is the path ahead. I can talk more about this point through the discussion. My third point is about some misunderstandings. There are in Israel, I felt from all my discussions with Israeli colleagues, that there are three main misunderstandings about the Arab Peace Initiative. The first is about refugees. The second about the relationship between the comprehensive and the bilateral. And the third is about if it is take it or leave it plan. The third one, take it or leave it plan, I already clarified that it is not a take it or leave it plan. It is not an alternative to the bilateral tracks. So it's not take it or leave it. It is a point of departure for bilateral negotiations. So it is not a take it or leave it plan. The comprehensive and the bilateral, it is comprehensive. It's talk about comprehensive peace, but start with the bilateral. Therefore, it does not contradict with the bilateral. But the most important one is refugees. Refugees. In the Arab Peace Initiative, there is Article 1B and Article 4 of the Arab Peace Initiative, both of them about refugees. Article A, 1B, states as follows. Agreed upon solution to the refugee problem in accordance with Resolution 194. While Article 4 speaks about rejection of all types of resettlement of refugees, taking in consideration the special status of the hosting countries. This is what it states. Let me come to these two one by one. The first one, Article 1B, which speaks about, you know, agreed upon solution. Of course, as you see that this resolution, this Article 1B, of course, it's mentioning the resolution of the UN General Assembly Resolution 194. But at the same time, it speaks about agreed upon solution, which means that the solution of the refugee problem will be agreed upon with Israel. It will be subject to negotiations with Israel. So they did not say in accordance with 194 full stop. Before saying in accordance to 194, they said agreed upon solution. A solution to be agreed upon. Therefore, a solution to be subject to negotiations to both sides. Why they did it that way, why they wrote it that way, it's obvious that they took in consideration the negotiations of Camp David 2000 and Taba 2001, which happened before the Arab Peace Initiative was released. The Arab Peace Initiative was released in 2002, but the Camp David negotiations and Taba negotiations were in 2000 and 2001. And you remember in Taba, the five options of refugees were developed, which is return to the Palestinian state, to the swabbed areas, or go back to Israel subject to the sovereign decision of Israel about the criteria and the quantity of the people that will go to inside Israel, stay wherever they are, or go to a third country. These are were the five options that there were developed in during Taba negotiations of January 2001. Therefore, the Arab Peace Initiative coming after these kinds, you know, of negotiations that led to these five options, the Arab Peace Initiative will take these negotiations in consideration. Therefore, it talked about agreed upon solution, which means negotiated solution about the issue. Therefore, where is the fear about that? There should be no fear, because Israel, as you see, has, if you like, even, I'll put it, you know, bluntly, has the right to veto at the end. The Arab Peace Initiative gave Israel the right to veto the right of return by saying that agreed, when the Arab state said agreed upon solution, it gave Israel the right to say no return to inside Israel, or to say we can accept the return of symbolic number of refugees. But it is at the end up to Israel, because it's agreed upon solution. The other article, which is article number 4, which spoke about, you know, rejecting resettlement. Actually, this article was made that way in response to the request of Lebanon. You know the demographic balance in Lebanon. Therefore, Lebanon do not want refugees to be resettled in Lebanon in order not to make problem to the demographic balance that Lebanon has between Christians, Muslims, Christians and Muslims in Lebanon. So this was in order to satisfy Lebanon. But on the other hand, while satisfying Lebanon by stating that way, still this is not contradictory of having Article 1B, which says that the other options, including the option of return, will be subject to negotiations with Israel. So yes, that they reject resettlement inside Israel, but on the other hand, they say that refugees has the right to, that the resolution of the refugee problem will be agreed upon between the two sides.
Yeah, actually on this, let me say the following. You know, in Palestine,
In Palestine, there are, as you know, there are two schools of thought about peace. Let me start with the one of Hamas. Hamas, they already know, mainly Mash'al, their, you know, their general secretary. They know that they already know from their experience that they cannot defeat Israel. And therefore, they are trying to find a formula of calmness, if you like, a formula of calmness with Israel that will be not, you know, that will not a type of calmness that will be for a short-term period, but for a long-term period, a long-term period. Let me remind you here of the proposal of Ghazi Hamad and the other one of Ahmed Yusuf from Hamas 4 or 5 years ago, when they talked about Hudna agreement with Israel for 50 to 60 years. So this was the idea that they presented at that time, which means that they want to try, because they know that they cannot defeat Israel, they want some kind of a long-term Hudna. And by the way, those who do not know the Islamic terminology, Hudna in the Islamic terminology is a contract. It is an agreement that the two sides sit together in the negotiations table and they sign. This is the contract. This is the Hudna. The Hudna means, the word Hudna means a cessation of hostilities for agreed upon period. But this cessation of hostilities for agreed upon period need the two sides to sit together in the negotiations table to agree on the following, to agree on the time of the Hudna, how long it will be there, how long it will continue, and the parameters of it, what the agreement, what each side should do during the period of the Hudna. When I presented this idea to rabbis of Shas that I talked to, this was my first time to lecture to rabbis from Shas. This was a month ago in Jerusalem. They said it might be a good idea to have revolving Hudna instead of peace, you know, some kind. So they liked the idea, but whatever. So, but this is the idea of Hamas. So Hamas is not anymore for, you know, liberation war against Israel. They are for Hudna that, and some leaders of Hamas like Ahmed Yusuf and Ghazi Hamad will say if the Hudna will work very well, then it can be the period of the Hudna, and when the first term of the Hudna will finish, we can negotiate another term. So extension of the Hudna, therefore this idea of revolving Hudna that the people of Shas has against. So still, of course, this is not a peace plan, it is a Hudna plan, but in one hand, it means that they are not anymore with the idea of liberation war or jihad, continuous jihad. They try to find a way that will make calmness with Israel without recognizing Israel, without, you know, making this, you know, jumping this taboo in their, you know, thought, which is recognizing Israel. So they don't want to, in one hand, they don't want war, in second hand, they do not want to recognize Israel, and they are playing it in between. Now, Mash'al, in his interview with Newsweek or Times, it was the last two weeks ago, I forgot it, it's in Newsweek or Times, the journalist asked him the following. After the establishment of the Palestinian state, will you recognize Israel? His answer was as follows. This is an issue for the Palestinian state to reconsider after its establishment. So now, for the first time, he's not saying no, we will not recognize, which he was which previously he was saying. When you ask him, will you recognize Israel, he was saying no immediately. But now, for the first time ever, he said this is something to consider. So this is a new language. Of course, after he came to Gaza a few days later, he talked in Gaza about liberation of full Palestine and etc. But you see, you know, the opportunism of politicians in one hand. But you can see there is something that you can, that you can build on, have a strong dialogue, strong engagement with Hamas in order to develop their positions. This is a possibility that is there with the, and also taking consideration the possible influence of the Muslim Brotherhoods of Egypt. Now, Muslim Brotherhoods are for the first time ever being the authority in Egypt, and they have influence on Hamas that one can use. And this is, you know, one of the issues to link it with the Arab Peace Initiative. When we talk about Israeli Palestinian bilateral negotiations with the coverage of the Arab Peace Initiative, it means it will mean using the good offices of the Arab countries in order to promote the bilateral peace. In this regard, one will think about Egypt talking with Hamas in order to make sure that Hamas will not reject the agreement that will take place between Abu Mazen and Israel. So this is, so when you say about bilateral negotiations with the coverage of the Arab Peace Initiative, you will ask the Arab countries to play a role on that. Egypt will ask to talk to Hamas in order not to spoil the process. The Jordanians and the Saudis and will be asked also to join in the discussions about refugees and Jerusalem, therefore are to have some kind of a say regarding the issues of refugees and Jerusalem that can help moving the process forward. So the Arab Peace Initiative, what's still lacking, I would say, is developing this, you know, clear-cut mechanism for its implementation that will define clearly the role of each one of the Arab countries in promoting it. But I mentioned some of the clear cut, you know, ways ahead on this in this regard. Did I answer the question? Yes. Okay.
בגלל הזמן, אני רוצה ננסה להיצמד ל...
Of course, the second school of thought is Abu Mazen. And Abu Mazen, let us remember that the UN resolution of recognizing the Palestinian statehood, he did that in order to keep the two-state solution, you know, option alive. This is the yes. And now the Arab Peace Initiative in the resolution to the UN, the Arab Peace Initiative is included in the resolution. And he did that in order to keep this resolution alive because he think, you know, opposite to all of these discussions among, you know, academics about moving from two-state solutions to one-state solution, which is a luxurious, you know, discussion. Romantic discussion, I will call it, romantic discussion. Beyond that, Abu Mazen feeling was that Netanyahu government is, you know, making this creeping annexation as a de facto, if not a de jure, as a de facto creeping annexation, which is creating, in fact, instead of leading to two-state solutions, leading in the opposite to the growing Israel in the expense of diminishing Palestine. So this is what's going on. So there is one state solution. The biggest Israel is creeping as one state solution, as one state Israeli, you know, state on the expense of Palestinians. So what Abu Mazen did is rescuing the two state solutions by going to the UN and get from the UN recognition of Palestinian state.